So, big data, before they called, you have data mining, but before that you had knowledge discovery systems, you had machine learning, it all fits more or less for me in the same pool. Is there a difference between big data and data mining? Maybe there is, depends on the angle you, depends on your own definition, of course, because you'll find many definitions. I think it has more to do with the size, because you can apply algorithms the same to larger and bigger sizes. It depends on your own definition, but we're all looking for, please join us. But we're all trying to extract information in one way or another, depending on the algorithm we're using. So, okay. My view on data mining, as a basic teacher, so I'm teaching people about data mining at home, I'll try to explore the data and apply some machine learning techniques, basically supervised and unsupervised learning. What does this mean? So I don't know if everybody's familiar with data mining. Supervised means there's a target. So probably everybody has had statistics in the past. So you have something like linear regression where you're trying to predict something, so there's a target. Unsupervised is just like we're exploring the data and trying to represent them in a meaningful way and extracting some knowledge from that. But there's no real target in unsupervised learning. So, okay. Basic setup often used is then to divide our data, the data we've got, into a training, validation, and test set, or a training and validation set, if you go quicker. What does this mean? A training set is being used to build our model. So we use the information within our training set to build our model, maybe several models, and test them against the validation set to tune our model, to choose the right model, which implicitly means that we've used the information of our validation set as well to choose a model. So then finally, we added a small test set, which our model has never seen before, just to make sure is the model okay. So it's a basic setup that's often been used if you have enough data. Okay, so we need samples. Samples need to be big enough, random, stratified if possible. What does it mean, stratification? These guys are not stratified sample of a population. No ladies, no women in here. It's not good representation of population, for example. So stratified depends always on the population or the table you're looking at. So three common choices in data mining are from statistics point of view, Python, as a general purpose, scientific language, and Scala coming up for parallel computing. So these are all common choices you'll find in the open world. So now let's talk about PostgreSQL as a data store within this context. So I'll go over basic setup, some basic tests, some basic tuning. I'll talk about loading the data, space consumption, sampling, and then about columnar storage within PostgreSQL. Okay. So, I'm a teacher. We don't have these big machines, so I get some virtual machines I can play around with, but I suppose you can scale it up to the same number. So we are basically interested in read performance. We're not running an operational system. We're not running a transactional system. Just running analytics on our system. So that's our basic goal there. In this case, I have an 8 GB virtual machine. So that's the one I can use. So some basic tests for this that everybody can run, especially in this case, is PG test timing, I think, since we're using a virtual machine, and sometimes these timings can be a bit misleading because of running the extra layer of virtualization. So can we trust the timings or not? So after running the tests on the machine I used, this was quite okay. The overhead was not too much. I could trust the statistics and come out of that one. Okay. So for the basic tuning, there's one parameter called effective cast size, as everybody knows. So on this system, it means that about almost 5 GB, so the amount of free memory plus buffers and cache is almost 4.9, if you like. So I could choose there 4 or 5, depending, because it always changes, of course, this amount. But this would be a good setting, I think, to continue. So this is the basic things I changed, not much. Of course, I altered since a few versions, we've got parallel workers, so parallel querying. So I've got 4 cores, I put it at 2, 2. Let's see if it gets used later or not. Okay. Loading the data, so copy command. When using this, you might want to reset the maintenance workman temporarily for that period, because it will can seriously increase the mean speed up there. Don't forget to run analyze afterwards. when you've created freshly tables, so your statistics get updated, and your planner can take the right as the right information for that. The only thing you should avoid, that's basically what I have to tell my students often, is don't use single row inserts. Then you get single transactions, and then it really gets a lot slower. So a word about streaming data. At some point, we were running a project week at home, and we had that attendance for the students. So the normal way of doing this is we lay down a paper with some names, and you put your signature there, and then you're there. But then we're over 400 students, only with 10 teachers, so this takes a lot of work every day, checking if everybody's there. So the next step would be to use their student cards and to scan them. But it took about 10 seconds to scan every card. So we've got 400 students, 10 seconds, so 4,000 seconds, which is more than an hour. So we want to automate that a step further, so we talked about Wi-Fi access points, and we asked the students, is this okay for your privacy, that we use the Wi-Fi connection to register if you're there or not, because they had to authenticate on the Wi-Fi network. So then I looked at the Radius system, I had to combine two locks, combine them, and it worked. Yeah, so I could measure attendance in that way. Of course, I asked for permission first. After the project week was gone, I didn't mind for the system anymore because I quickly set it up. After a few months, well, the server had some problems. Apparently the disk space had run full, of course. Scripts kept on running. I just tried to delete a bunch of it, but it didn't really work because deleting stuff doesn't really change the table size. You need to vacuum full it, but then you had to have other place, so the table gets rewritten. There was no space left. So if you do these kind of things with streaming data, maybe put them in a staging area before your analytical database, or make sure you manage them so they don't impact other stuff. Fortunately, it was not an important server, but okay. So what about space consumption? You can use different tools for that one. This is the first time I show you the table as well. So it's about a gyroscope. So every phone has a sensor in it, many sensors. One of these is the gyroscope. So it has three-dimensional coordinates of how you're holding your phone. Well, it seems there's still some space free. Let's investigate on it more. Why did I choose this topic? I was inspired by this news article I saw. So if you're pushing in your PIN on your phone, you might move it a bit. And the gyroscope detects this. So if you got an app or something else reading out your gyroscope, you could actually deduce your PIN number being put in there. So the data set I used is also of a gyroscope, but not with the PIN numbers. It's with people either sitting down, running on a bike, going upstairs with the information of the gyroscope. So to see if I could find analog information about that one. So more detailed, we see that's fine. So our space consumption, which is to be expected, because we freshly created a table. The default fill factor for a table is 100%, so not losing a lot of space in there. Okay. So next step, let's look at sampling. Since 9.4, we have a table sample option in the from component. So it can have two options, system or Bernoulli. Is any familiar with those two options? Yeah, so not everybody. So system means we randomly pick blocks. So it's on a block level. So we take every row in the block and it's put in a sample. While Bernoulli will do it on a row level. So it's more random, so it will pick either row, yes or no, it will get picked. So let's compare them for performance. Let's first try the system, which is on a block level. So it will check a whole block. So in this case, we take a 50% sample and it takes about 32 seconds to run. Okay? So, execution time, it takes about 32 seconds to run for a table sample using system. Now we use the other system, Bernoulli, which is on a row level system. So now it's about 5 seconds to run, 5.8. I see some people tilting their head, it's good. So, what is this? Bernoulli seems faster. So Bernoulli is on a row level, the other one is doing it on a block level. Any suggestions? Anybody want to heckle or? Why is this happening? They're all good DBAs. Yes, that's it. That's it. So, of course, this is a caching problem. You're doing tests, but you should repeat your tests, or you should. So, Is this still working? Okay, now. So, of course, it has to do about caching. So you can check your cache with another extension, and then you can see that cache grows each time this amount. Apparently for sample scans, as they are shown in the explain plan, they have the same growth as sequential scans within this cache, because I noticed them going up at the same amount. Also the cost of explain, I don't know if you noticed, but I summarized it a bit. Yeah, of course you can reset your cache, and then the system method is a lot faster. Didn't I? One moment, here we go. So what do we see? That the system method has a higher cost actually, which was a bit surprising to me, because often explain gives a good cost. I checked it with others, other values, and apparently, yeah, so there's some tuning needed there, because if you just go on the cost, you would choose Bernoulli. Yeah. So it's a bit strange, but system method, of course, is faster. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, that's what I, I tried 50%, and then I went down. And there was a tipping point around 20-25%. When they came more or less equal, and then it changed beneath that. But anyway, of course. But in this case, it shouldn't be like that. So the statistics are a bit off. Also, changed the random page cost and stuff like that. Try that one. Didn't it impact anything? So, yeah. Okay. Yeah, of course. Don't forget sync. So another option, we've got our table sample methods, which are built in now, which has been along. So just using a random sort order. We take our table and we randomly sort it. So then we get a random sample, of course. So first so many rows are a random sample. First 100 rows, 4,000 rows, whatever. So in this case, this is half of the rows. Well, as you can imagine, by the slide you're seeing, this might take a bit of space, this might take a bit of time. You might want to change your work memory there to pump it a bit. Okay, so what's the next section then? Instead of just doing that, I want to have some more information about it. I add a random column. To the table, I add a column with random values. So that I can use then, of course, to do sampling on, to use them as a sample table. So we have some options. First option is to add a column and to update it. The second option is to add a column and give it directly a random value. Third option is to create it on the fly. While I'm loading my data from another, or while I'm creating it, just adding it on the fly on creation. So what you see then is, looking at sizes and performance, adding a column and doing an update afterwards is substantially slower than the other two options. This should not come as a surprise to people who have done this a lot, I think. I just checked it again, and it's also size-wise, you need to run a vacuum full, and then it will have the same size as the other two options. So in conclusion, I would say, if you use this method, don't use an add column and update. Just do it on the fly or do it on creation time. Okay. So is there something else we can do to make this table more performant? Now we've got a table with our data, one column with all aselect or random values. So how, because the table isn't random yet. Perfect, yeah. So we could cluster on that column. We make an index on that last column, and of course we cluster on it, and then it's randomly ordered. So if you read the first block out, you get a random sample. If you read the first two blocks out, you get a random sample. And we don't need to go through all the other blocks. We just we can just read them sequentially. Okay, so, okay, is this really random? Another question. So we're using this random function. So what I did is, this is just a query to show that actually we've got some collisions. So we got two random values. So we got about 44,000 collisions of random value of the same value as of two. So three times the same random value of 106, and four times the same random value, one. So random is a 15 number digit. So we can have collisions there. It's not that much. If you compare it to the total table size, we'll find it's a low percentage. So it's not a real problem. Of course, this goes up as the table grows. As I've said before, our table was about, I think I've shown it already, was about 1.4 gigabyte. It's big, but not that big. So if your table goes up, you might want to think about this one. So you might want to add a second random column or whatever, but you need more entropy, more randomness in your table there. Okay, so this is to summarize it. In sampling, so we've got these two built-in methods. These two I didn't talk about because I left out the slides, but these are extensions you can add. And they're basically the same as the system method. So the system method does sampling on a block level. What does system rows does? It will exactly that amount of rows. Instead of a parameter, it's a percentage. Now the parameter is the number of rows you're retrieving. So you have the exact number of rows. System time is interesting for performance or for responsiveness, because there the parameter is on a block level again, but the parameter is the amount of time you get for reading the table. So, and then of course the last two we saw. It depends all what you want. Do you want a quick sample? Do you want a good sample? Are you going to invest more time? I'm not sticking with one option here. Like, this is the option you should choose. Depends on what you're looking at. Okay. So, yeah. So, are they good samples? Are they good samples? Because I said less in there for those two blocks. So, what we can do is calculate some basic statistics. We can get averages, variances, and the number of elements we got. So, we can use that to do some basic statistics on a column in our sample. So that's what I did. And to summarize that in the table, so we've got all our sampling methods. And let's say we take two samples. So we want the sample to be repeatable. We want to have more or less the same results. So as the first option you already see here, so if we take an hypothesis test to compare the averages, in the system method, which is 0.1 percentage sample for our table, we get a significant difference in the average of our two samples, which isn't what we want. The same if we compare it to the population. It's not representing the population, either of those samples. The other methods, well, they're okay. Basically because these two, they get a bigger row percentage. The sample is bigger. So that compensates for being less random, but still having enough data in there. Because we see these samples, of course, they're a bit bigger. Oh. If you have smaller samples, Bernoulli is fine, works fine, but it takes longer. You definitely see it. It takes about 500 times longer than the system method. Than this one, 100 times longer. If you increase this one, so when we go up to 50%, you will see that Bernoulli is almost about the same time as system. So it really depends on the table, on the sample size there. Okay. So in conclusion, let's say, if you're using these built-in quick methods, make sure your sample is big enough. Otherwise, you'll likely end up with a sample that's not good to use. So, okay. What about columnar storage? Everybody understands the concept of CStore? What's the background of CStore? So instead of storing everything into rows, so our block is filled with rows, let's take, for example, the first column and put that into a block or several blocks, of course, and so on. There's a general idea behind it, because then if we summarize, for example, all the values of that column, we just need to read those blocks. We don't need to read every block that contains that row. So it should speed up stuff. So I give you some Debian install tips, which a size comparison and then some performance. So for Debian, you need to install an extra package, which I didn't find in the instructions, but that's why I'm putting it in there. And in general, you just need to add a shared pre-wrote library, the CStore, and then you can start using it. So what about the sizes? You cannot use a shorthand notation for that in PSQL or whatever. You'll have to look it up by the IDs. And once you've got the table ID or the table name, you'll have to look it up on a file system level. So now we see that our table, since I've left out a few slides to make it quicker, our table is about 1.1 gigabyte. That's our CStore. Our compressed CStore is 352 gigabyte. So it's a bit, it's really some performance gain, especially if you compare to our previous table size, which was about 1.4. So if I do 350 times 4, I have 1400. So it's about four times as small a compressed CStore. So you really pays off there. Not compressed is also smaller. So what about OLAP? Because this is typically designed for data warehousing and OLAP operations. So we could do something like a rollup cube or grouping sets. For those not familiar with rollup, rollup is just like a normal group by on GD with an extra query doing a group by, but then without a group by, so general aggregate of the whole table, if you like. OLAP performance, it depends. It really depends on the query you're running. If there was a trigger, an index that got triggered, then, especially in the where condition, if you had a small piece of it, small slice and dice, if you like, then it had a bigger impact than a group by. Also for using CStore, the way you created the CStore is very important. I'll show that later. So the way you create, the way the data is inserted is important there. If you're just comparing CStore with normal tables, well, CStore wins here. And a compressed CStore is also about the same size as an index. So you could create, of course, an index on a regular table, but if you look size-wise, it's actually quite interesting. Another thing I noted was you can use rollup, you can use cube, you can use grouping sets, but it's union was faster in most cases if you have parallel querying enabled, because then the two queries or three whatever, they will get fired at the same time. So you might want to think of that. It's not so nice in coding, of course, but it will be quicker. So, as a summary, I would say from slow to fast. The slowest is a regular table with no index being used. Then you've got CStore. Then you've got CStore with a good sorting order for our query. And then you've got regular tables where the index gets used. In general, also CStore regular was slower than compressed CStore. So, what do you need to know about this extension? You can do no updates, no deletes. So you have to write it once and yeah, it has to be like that. You can append data. So when writing it, it's important that you put in the right sort order. Why? Because it doesn't use indexes, but it, for each block, it will keep a minimum maximum value of each block. So instead of having to go through all the blocks, all the rows in the, all the elements in the block, you can just check if this, if the value is within the range of this minimum maximum value. If it's not, it can skip the whole block without reading it. So that's how it speeds up its operation. Uses of random function is about the same. So within these things, I would say CStore, if you're looking for these kinds of things, it's a good option. So let's talk about Orange. Orange is a tool in data mining. Okay, so it's built on Python. And then again, so it was built on NumPy, SciPy, and SkyKit Learn. So we'll talk about the setup, performance, the GUI you can use, some side effects, short demo, a bit about Python and pgpredict, and if you have time for dessert, there will be a dessert. So the setup. If I set this up with my students, I usually have no problems there, apart from time to time I have some layer 8 problems. So for those who are familiar with the OSI model, we can have some layer 8 problems over there sometimes. The software itself, it's not as stable as PostgreSQL. Because I think PostgreSQL, you can throw rocks at it, you can kick it, it will keep on running. Orange is not like that. I think most software isn't like PostgreSQL, so you'll have to deal with that a bit. But apart from that, it's quite okay. The guidelines for Linux are a bit spread out if you want to install it for your own system. So I'll add these Debian-specific tips. So you need to install these packages. Some of them are on the site, some of them just by experiencing it. You can use Anaconda. So there's a whole Anaconda distribution. Or you can use Python install package. Or you can install it from development. To support the tables, to have table support for PostgreSQL, you need to install this extension, and then it will pick it up. What I do, I usually use virtual environments when I install something from Python that isn't in the repository, because I don't want to interfere it with my system, local system packages that are in the repository. So I install it within a virtual environment, which is often also recommended by many of these projects. Let's look at the performance. mainly memory and CPU usage of Orange. So memory depends on the widgets that are being used, what kind of memory is being used. And for machine learning, Orange needs the data to be in memory. It's not like a database that can, so it needs to be, the full data needs to be into memory. So in practice, this means when you're using the Orange GUI, it's only about 4% of the system's memory, that's with the things I tested, because otherwise you have to wait too long. You want the GUI to be responsive. You can wait for like maybe 10, 20 seconds, but you don't want to wait like half an hour. If you want to wait for half an hour, put it in a script. So, okay. Fortunately, Orange will also suggest that to you. It will say, this data set is too big to handle. Should I take a sample? So, and these samples are then taken for you, either based on the system method, or either based on the system time method, which are, as if you recall, on a block level based. So they're quick, but they might have to take care that they're big enough. In practice, if you take about 5% of a database or big enough on big tables, then you're okay. If the tables are small, then you won't have these problems because Orange will be able to deal with them. In the CPU, that's something else. Because the limitation of the data sets you can handle is not only limited by the memory. Many of these processes are run by a single core, I noticed. They're not parallelized. So you're actually bound. You can give it more memory, but if it's only handled by one CPU, you don't want to keep on waiting. So not every machine learning technique in there is being handled by several cores. Okay. This is from my test that I did. So if you have, for example, a database, a table from 1 gigabyte, in your memory, it will go to 4 gigabytes for processing. And it can go up even to 12 gigabytes for processing. It will go up to 4 when you put it in nicely, which means you put in the metadata like this is the headers, this is my target, these are continuous variables, these are discrete variables. If you give it that information, it will scale up to a factor 4. If it doesn't have a lot of information, it can grow to up to a factor 12, so which is quite a lot. So okay. So there are some other side effects. Since often samples are taken then, you will see that the sample is written to your database. You don't notice this, because you're just using Orange, you're connecting to a database, you're reading out the table, and then Orange for you creates some tables in the background. So if your disk starts growing unexpectedly or whatever, because you've created so many samples, that's the place to look. They don't get deleted after you close Orange. They stay in there. So it's not in the documentation, I didn't find it, but it's, I think, something, yeah. Okay. So you can load a widget, you can connect, as usual, to a database. And on the right-hand side, I've put the log table and then just the connection to the database. So you'll see there are things going on. It's querying the database. It's taking a sample, and it's already created a sample table over there, which wasn't there before. So I didn't ask for it, but that's what it does. So I want to be it in memory, because I want to work on it. It's a big table, but let's try it anyway. So it says, no, it's too big. So okay, I'll take a sample. So the next thing you need to know is, within a standard table, there's no real target. So you need to define a target. So this can be done with a widget called select columns, for example. So I've pre-filled it. Normally they're all in the feature side. So I need the target. GT is like I'm biking, I'm sitting, I'm standing up. Remember, it was about a mobile phone. Okay. So, one moment. Yeah, of course, I need to take a sample. And now I'm going to just show how much time this takes and the memory usage a bit. So in sampling, I'll get two methods that I can use, either time limited or either I want a fixed percentage of my data. So the system or system time method. As you will see, one CPU is being used. And it's running in the background, okay? So, yeah, I'll finish in a few seconds. So, yeah, got a signal, that's okay. So in this case, it was just 1 second. So if you check again, you will see that if you do 1%, it will create a background page, a background table just as well. Okay. So I don't know if I, because while this is running, you see these tables get created. It's not too difficult to use Orange. I don't know if people have, because that's one of the reasons why I'm showing this as well. So you can easily put in a widget there and make a natural workflow. That's one of the reasons why I use it with my students as well, because otherwise I have to, I used to come from R to write all these scripts, which also works fine, but okay. So to show some data mining techniques, so we then can of course use that sample again. What do I want? I want the data in local memory so I can use the normal sampling method, dividing it into a training and test set, for example. So these things are being done. I take a sample, in this case 70-30, just I'm not using a test set, okay. So this goes fairly quickly, since all data is in memory. And then I can use any data mining technique. So again, to show you how easy it is, so you just choose any that you want. In this case, I'm taking KNN, which is for the K nearest neighbors. So if I were to guess Heike's nationality, and I see David sitting next to him, I would say Heike is an American, based on one NN, for example. Or, yeah, you get the picture, that's the idea behind it. Then I've got, of course, decision trees, which are just splitting up according to an information gain criterion, so making every time. And I've got logistic regression, which is about the same thing as normal regression, instead it's for use for classification. So you use, it's based on odds and odds ratios, if you like. So then I need to evaluate these techniques, which technique works the best for our data set. So the only thing I need to do is connect these machine learning techniques to the evaluation widget, test and score. I need to feed it. Okay, this is, I left it in on purpose. So you see Orange isn't that stable already, but it will continue, it will work. So I need to feed it with my data. So it needs the two types of data. It needs the original training data and it needs our test data, of course. And again, yeah. You see? So, but this is fine because the standards, there was no method selected. So now I select a method, test it on the train data, which is what you should always do. Never test on, test it on the test data, because training data and then you're just using your model again. In this case, it appeared that if you take classification accuracy as a measurement, that the tree was best, I believe. Okay. So I'm going to show one final movie, and then we'll continue. So the tree method was the best. Classification accuracy, what does it mean? It means I'm predicting for everybody where do you come from. So I've got like, this is being recorded. So I've got like 500 people in this room, and out of those 500 people, I've got 150 who I classified correctly. So that's 150 out of 500, that's my classification accuracy. That's being put in a confusion matrix. So everything on the diagonal is correctly predicted. I then can combine that with a predictions widget, just to see if I send those flows, just to see if I select only the misclassified, for example, which ones got misclassified. So the first one is about walk. Well, it actually was predicted as stairs down, and so on. I can do the same with the ones that got correctly classified, or I can just select them up there in the matrix. But it's quite interactive. That's my main point why I'm showing this. You don't have to write a lot of code. You don't have to do a lot of things. The interaction is there. As long as you make the right flows, work quite well. So we'll do the same with a scatter plot, trying to visualize the data, trying to get an idea of it. Well, the data was quite big, I don't know if you remember, so it might be too big to fit on a plot. I mean, to be given in a plot that's fully informational. So I'm gonna send it to a second plot to just to get a limited view out of it. So I'm selecting later a smaller area. So this is all the data. So if you hover over a single unit, you will get all the predictions, values, and the original values. So now I'm just sending the ones that were correct. The ones that were correct are all the ones that are fully colored. So now misclassified. Now the misclassified will be fully colored and the other ones will be. But it's hard to see on this picture. It's hard to see because there's so much data in there. So what can you do? The next thing is I want to investigate on this area. So I zoom in on this area. So I make sure that the selected data from one gets the information from there. So it looks maybe harder than it is, but it's actually quite simple. So I just select some data in there. And then I get in the other widget, the other scatter plot, I only get a view on those, that data. And now I get a clear picture over there. So every bullet in there that's full is actually correctly classified or vice versa, depending on the confusion matrix, what I selected, and everything that's not fully colored the other way around. But it allows me to really interactively go through that. Okay. I'm going to continue with this one. Sorry? 10 minutes, perfect. Perfect, so I rushed a bit, but it's okay. So, PLPython. So we can write scripts, Orange is based on Python. So we can use Python or PLPython. A note about PLPython, it's version 3 now. We need to access the virtual environment. So I'm showing this one for you. I didn't find anything for version 3 online. So I had to change it and adapt it myself. So you can use this one if you want to use a virtual environment inside your PL code. So here you go. So what you can do then is, you just load that function, and then within that session, within that database session, you're okay to load any library from Python from within the virtual environment. So without loading that function first, you won't be able to do that. So, and then of course you can use any data mining technique in there. You can use the same code, just straight what's within there, within the body, just as a normal Python script as well, of course. Apart from the PLPy, which is specific. Okay. So, what do you use? I think it's a matter of personal choice, or might be a policy. You want your scripts there, or you want your scripts in your database, whatever you're running. For me, I discovered Jupyter Notebook, and that's what I like right now, so I'm using that one. So I can keep all my scripts into the notebook, and then just get the results out of that one. So that's more or less what I use. A note about PGPredict. So PGPredict, it was written, I think, by Second Quadrant at some point, and they got some funding for making it. So let's go over it. The documentation needs a bit of an update. So you can download it from their site. You'll find the zip archive over there. Most of the information is in there. So what you need to do is you need to follow the instructions to add an extra widget to Orange. You'll need to create some extra functions, some database functions. And in documentation, they'll talk about mean, but actually it's a constant if you look for the right widget. So they change the naming in there. And the requirements will fail if you leave them like that. So the requirements.txt file or whatever. So you need to change Orange by Orange 3 there within that file. And then it works. Then you can install it. So they're basically supporting two learning techniques, which is regression and logistic regression, which makes sense because regression everybody knows. Like, I don't know, how tired am I equals 7 times the amount of beers of yesterday plus, and so on and so on. So these are just parameters. You can do the same with logistic regression, which is also just, so this is easy to translate. So it's a logical reason why they have chosen these techniques in there. If you look at the workflow, there's no scripting for it. You just use the Orange GUI. Then you export your model from the model you've built, which will create a JSON file. JSON file just containing the coefficients, difficult word, how you pronounce it? Thank you. So that's what I mean, of the model. And then you just load it into PGPredict, and then you can make your predictions. So that's basically how it works. So if you want to make predictions on your database, with a model created with Orange, then you can do it. But you can only do it for logistic regression and normal regression. It's the only ones that are available. And then you need to think about this one while you're doing that. So depending on your system, might not be a problem on Windows, I don't know, but PLPython is run by Postgres. And you're making, you're running Orange as yourself. So you're saving it, normally you're saving in this under your personal files, your home folder or whatever, and Postgres does not have access. So this means that the PLPython functions you'll be using doesn't have access to it as well, because Postgres will be executing it most of the time. So you'll need to put them in a place that Postgres can access them. What I personally do is I just put a link into the Postgres home folder, and that way I make sure he has access to the files. Okay. What else you can do? As I told you before, Orange needs the data to be in memory. But if you want to do tests on larger tables, for example, if you look at the root mean squared error, which is just something you can just perfectly write in SQL, you can do these tests, of course, on the database itself then. And so you can test your data, validate it against larger data sets than Orange can handle. Okay. So we're almost with the virtual dessert. So yeah, this is a tree, just to show you that only after three, one, two, three, on the fourth level, I'm already able to classify whether this person is walking, biking, or the default value null. Need more levels, but okay. And this is, of course, and this is another one. So this is the actual dessert. So apparently face recognition is quite a hype right now. There's no idea why. Some countries are really keen on it. So let's see if we can do that. So what we are trying to do is we've got a bunch of data. So these are all animals, and we want to classify them based just on their image. So we want to cluster, for example, chickens together, or cows together, or bigger animals, or whatever, just doing image analytics on them. It doesn't give a lot of data. So what we can do is, I have to show that one. So what we can do is connect to an external neural network. So that's why I'm showing that one on the right-hand side. It's not run locally, it's run remotely. And then we get a bunch more of parameters. So instead of the size, the width, and the height, I get up to about 2,000 information about neural nodes in my network. So that network has been built remotely. And then, of course, to see whatever I can cluster together, I need to define a distance matrix, because clustering is based on distances, how far are you apart, are you alike or not. So, for example, I have a bear in there, I have an elephant, I have a hen, a rooster, a goat, a horse. So I've got different animals, so elephants, bears, goats, and so on. So let's investigate on them, let's look at them and see if they fit nicely together. This is, again, quite interactively, because I'm just selecting these parts and I get to see, okay, the cows, yeah, they're pretty similar. So they're in the same group. That's fine. Okay. So let's see if we can add some more data and see if they get classified correctly. So I'm going to use, instead of only adding the Milka cow, I'm going to add this guy and this guy. So let's see how they get classified. It's called dessert or something. So what do we see? The Milka cow is selected with the Milka things. I didn't show that one again, so I showed another one. They also, they're also fine. So yeah, the elephant gets classified as an elephant, which I put in before because I only had two pictures. I didn't add four. And the bear gets classified as a bear. Why am I showing this? This is fun, of course. But I mean, data mining is, you're only as good in data mining as the quality of your data. Whatever you're feeding your data, I think this is really important, because if you look at, if your data contains lots of information you can't trust, what are you going to do about it? Of course, this wasn't an elephant and this wasn't a bear. But if I put it in there with the label of elephant or bear, that's what will come out. Okay. So, I hope I stick to the time limit. I've gone fairly quickly. Okay. So, is there any questions left?
Any questions, please?
So,
What is the difference between machine learning and data mining?
Machine learning, machine learning is more like in an academic, it's a word used in the academic context. So if you're talking to academics, they will usually call it machine learning. And if you're talking to a business or more professional, they will usually call it data mining. But actually, they're using the same techniques. No.
The difference is that machine learning invents mathematics, and data mining tries to learn something from data. So the goal of machine learning is algorithms and formulas, and not more than that.
What was up with the data in the end? Were you actually pulling gyroscope data from the attendance app?
Sorry?
Like, where did you get that gyroscope data from? Just curious.
It's public. It's public data set. Oh, okay. No. If you're into data mining, there are a couple of universities who've got a bunch of data sets. Because the first thing I wanted to do was looking at the data set, which could fit into my memory, but at the limits of it. And this happened to coincident with the fact of the fun fact of the gyroscope. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Who else?
So actually it worked as a conclusion. You can actually predict what the person is doing, sitting down or running up. So.
No more questions.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.